Good evening and welcome to the third Zofia Pakula lecture. We're delighted to have you with us. My name is Ronnie Kotha and I'm representing the University of Toronto Institute for Global Health, Equity and Innovation, the sponsor of today's event. The Institute is a university-wide entity promoting research, education and training focused on the intersection of health, equity and innovation, and is housed in the Dalai Lama School of Public Health. My colleague, Alex Haddad, director of the Institute, is in the audience with us. Alex, can you raise your hand, please? Thank you. Thanks. This year, the Zofia Pakula Lecture Series has been recast as an effort to wage peace and was moved into the Institute. We feel very fortunate to be the home of this important lecture series, as it is very much in line with one of the Institute's signature programs, the Safe Spaces Initiative, a commitment to providing a space and place within the academy to ask the unaskable questions and for tough conversations about taboo subjects so that we can become comfortable with discussing the uncomfortable, promoting respectful dialogue, especially where there are deep differences in opinion. The Zofia Pakula Lecture was created by our dear friend and colleague, Andrew Pakula. Andrew, can you raise your hand, please? Thank you. In celebration of his mother, a courageous Holocaust survivor and beloved family physician, a humanist who dedicated her life to healing rather than harming. Andrew has written a beautiful background on his mother's story, and I urge you to read about it in the program. It is especially poignant for me to think about Andrew and his mom, as this week I lost my own mother, a physician, to pancreatic cancer. Through my conversations with Andrew, I can see the parallels between the life of my mother and his mother. Both dedicated their lives to healing and thus were committed to go to medical school in their native country. Both had to retrain in their adopted country. For Zofia, it was Canada, and for my mom, it was the United States. And to pursue their residency in their 40s, oftentimes working alongside students in their 20s, to be able to work in their new country and in their chosen field. I'm so moved by Andrew's efforts to honor his mother's beautiful spirit by ensuring that he created something that drew on her life and her beliefs. This series was created so that we, in the academy, do not forget that war is an anathema to well-being and health. We are afforded an opportunity to reflect on the interrelationships between health, war, peace, and human rights. Rather than be motivated by racism, ethnocentrism, classism, and sexism, why not choose to be moved by humanism, like Zofia Pakula? So thank you, Andrew, for allowing us to be guided by your mom's beautiful spirit. And now I will introduce our speakers. First, it is my deep, deep privilege to introduce Chandler Davis, a mathematician and professor who has had a lifetime unpaid career of questioning authority. Earning 3 degrees at Harvard, Chandler went on to hold a tenure-track position at the University of Michigan from 1950 to 1954, during a time when the U.S. government, aided and abetted by university administration, was cracking down on leftists in academia. He was accused of subversive activities for passing out communist literature and refusing to cooperate with a congressional investigation on his political actions. Rather than defend himself the way that his friends and even his father had done, which was to plead the Fifth Amendment, refusing to answer questions in order not to incriminate himself. He chose instead to defend his actions by pleading the First Amendment, arguing his constitutionally protected right to free speech. He understood by going this route, this was a long shot defense, and that he stood a good chance of going to jail, which he did. In fact, he was sentenced to 6 months in jail and fired from his position at the University of Michigan. Blacklisted as a professor in the US, Chandler thus came to the University of Toronto and from 1962 onwards has been a professor or professor emeritus of mathematics here. During that time, he has worked on campaigns against racism, against nuclear arms, and against the destruction of the ecosystem through organizations like Science for Peace, which he will discuss with you today. After his remarks, Chandler will be joining conversation with Howard Hu, Dean of the Dalhousie School of Public Health. Howard, like Chandler, also received 3 degrees from Harvard. And like Chandler, served as a faculty member at the University of Michigan before joining the University of Toronto. As a physician scientist academic with a background in environmental and occupational health and epidemiology, he has used his scientific expertise to shed light on human rights abuses that involve the effects of toxic exposures to civilian populations in conflict situations, as well as scientific investigations of indigenous populations exposed to industrial and mining wastes. He is a founding member of Physicians for Human Rights and served as the director of the Research Commission for the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War on the health effects of atomic weapon production, an organization that Chandler has also been involved with. After Chandler's lecture, we will kick off the discussion with Chandler and Howard with a few questions that have been provided by students and community members that draw on each of their experiences and expertise. We will then open up the discussion to questions from the floor. So please join me in a warm welcome to Chandler Davis.
My apologies to all of you. I owe you all an apology. I owe the whole world an apology. All my generation owes the world an apology for leaving things in such a mess. I'm talking about the period 1950 to 1990. We were most active, and our children were not yet ready to take over. I really think we didn't meet the challenge. Some of us sure tried. Let me ask you to look with sympathy on the world as it looked to us then, and the tragedy of our failure to meet the needs. Joseph Rotblat, one of the early leaders in the study of nuclear chain reactions, resigned from the Manhattan Project in 1944 when it became clear that the Nazis were not going to succeed in making a nuclear bomb. At the time, he was the only scientist to quit the bomb project on grounds of conscience. As physicians have a Hippocratic oath telling them not to use their science against humanity, Rotblat said all scientists should be bound by a corresponding rule: science must not do harm. All honor to him. After the Manhattan Project had succeeded in producing fission bombs, and especially after the US had used them in a drastically anti-human way on 2 Japanese cities, many of us followed Rotblat's lead, joining organizations like the Federation of American Scientists and the Pugwash movement. We contacted our representatives and we thought they were paying attention. Why, when I was entering graduate school in 1946, many around the world believed in the Baruch Plan, not just innocent scientists and leftists. Bernard Baruch and Dean Acheson were leaders of international finance. Nobody talks about the Baruch plan these days, and you may think we were naive to think it ever had a chance, but you should excuse us. The governments of the United States, Canada, and Britain were on record in favor of immediately abolishing nuclear weapons and putting all nuclear efforts worldwide under the UN confined to peaceful uses. How could we not be optimistic? But Winston Churchill's Iron Curtain speech had already been delivered that same year, announcing the start of the Cold War. And some of the spokesmen for the Baruch Plan were already swept up in the arms race. In the next 2 years, the nuclear arms race was the primary reality. Appalled neutrals floated the Stockholm Peace Pledge. At least let governments pledge not to be the first to use nuclear weapons. We leftists solicited signatures in all countries. It was an uphill struggle, with some scoffing that we were only supporting the Stockholm Pledge as long as the Soviets had no nuclear weapons. Well, the Soviets did get the bomb, and we still supported the pledge. So scoffers fell back on calling us naive. As I said, we tried. Maybe these campaigns helped restrain President Truman from using nukes in the Korean War. Linus and Ava Pauling gave dozens of lectures in several countries about the damage to health and the environment from testing nuclear bombs above ground. Thousands of us joined the campaign in more modest roles. We were elated when in 1963, President Kennedy and General Secretary Khrushchev agreed to stop the tests, the Partial Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. We had won. The feeling was justified in that they did stop the atmospheric tests, and the British and French did along with them. But our jubilation was flimsy. Nuclear powers didn't stop underground tests, and they didn't stop building up their nuclear stockpiles. Even as we were celebrating, nuclear weapons were being developed in India with Canadian collusion, and Israel with French collusion. The mighty think tanks, the RAND Corporation and counterparts in other countries were busy analyzing the strategy of MAD, MAD, mutually assured destruction. Both the Soviets and the Western Alliance boasted that they had so much firepower that if one side made a nuclear attack, the retaliation would annihilate it. This doctrine is associated with the name of Herman Kahn of the RAND Corporation, not to mention Stanley Kubrick, who deconstructed it in the bitter satire Dr. Strangelove. But it was already urged in the 1940s by John von Neumann. Strange feeling for me. Two of my important mentors, Paul Halmos in the US and Israel Halpern in Canada, were disciples of von Neumann and admired him profoundly. We all did. Let me try to convey how totally some of us nevertheless deplored his MAD doctrine. In 1945, when US President Harry Truman had the cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki destroyed by nuclear bombs, imagine that Emperor Hirohito had had the retaliatory strike capability. The MAD doctrine would have him press the button to annihilate Vancouver and Seattle, at least. The MAD doctrine represented itself as defensive, for the unacceptably drastic retaliation would deter any first strike. We are promoting peace, the MAD theorists said in all seriousness, but for the system to work, the retaliation has to be unfailing. How could I, as a junior scientist, be disloyal to this mathematically argued theory from one of the world's greatest mathematicians and sort of grandfather to me, a theory accepted by the high command of both superpowers? Here's what I said instead. If your rival attacks you with nuclear weapons, you should put all your forces into preventing retaliation. To destroy the Japanese cities, as Truman did, was a terrible crime. And to destroy two North American cities in reprisal would have been doubling the crime. The MAD doctrine was grotesque, as Kubrick saw. My impulse would have been to say to Herman Kahn and the rest, dunces, weren't you paying attention in the last class? Go back over your class notes. For we had explained so clearly that retaliation too would be a terrible crime. And we had done it before the Rand Corporation even existed. In Astounding Science Fiction, there was Theodore Sturgeon's story, Memorial, my story, The Nightmare, and best of all, Sturgeon's story, Thunder and Roses, all in 1946. Astounding was read, too, here and elsewhere, overseas. We had made the point. Yet once the Cold War, with its nuclear arms race, had overwhelmed the brief window of coexistence, the point was lost. Just like the Baruch Plan, it dropped out of the policy debates of the 1960s, and by the 1980s, it had pretty much dropped out of memory. Still, we thought we were making progress in other directions. The curse of colonialism was beginning to lift. With the Empire of India freed from British rule in 1947, though the curse of partition was as bad in its way, Algeria didn't break the colonial bond until 1962, Mozambique only in 1975. The anti-colonial movement could rightfully feel that a freer world was being made already in 1955, when the Bandung Conference brought together the governments of half the world, including Japan, China, Indonesia, Iran, Yugoslavia, and both India and Pakistan, in opposition to colonialism and to the Cold War. They imagined a third bloc, quelling the dangerous bluster of the Soviet bloc and the Western bloc. And they initiated the non-aligned movement, which in name still exists. Alas, that didn't stop border disputes between the non-aligned. It didn't stop the terrible slaughter of minorities by the military takeover in Indonesia in 1965. It didn't stop the ruthless attempt by Pakistan's leaders to subjugate East Pakistan, which despite them seceded in 1971 and became Bangladesh. It didn't stop the fratricidal Biafra War. We knew colonial powers would foment trouble in hopes of continuing to profit from the colonies, but we couldn't anticipate all the horrors. When the French withdrew from Indochina in 1954, it seemed like just one more in the succession of liberations. Ought we to have known that US presidents would not let this liberation stand, but would insist on attacking the newly independent countries? Maybe even if we had read Lyndon Johnson's mind, we wouldn't have been forearmed. Maybe he didn't himself foresee that he would embark on his terrible escalation. We made progress on abortion rights and sexual freedom. We didn't do it by sitting and waiting for the establishment to reform itself. We got out on the street. A line in front of the Morgenthaler Clinic that used to exist on Harvard Street, defending it against the anti-choicers. We made progress on equal opportunity in North American society. We didn't do it by sitting and waiting for the Jubilee. We did it by putting our bodies on the line. When the Selma marchers were confronting Governor George Wallace and Sheriff Jim Clark in Alabama, quite a brigade of Toronto sympathizers rallied outside the US consulate to show support. A few of them are here today, I think, looking for maybe didn't make it. I don't think I'm the only one who remembers that. Yeah, you were there. a few of them spent several cold nights in sleeping bags on the sidewalk. I think President Johnson knew Canada was watching him, the world was watching him, and it must have helped. Yes, that's the same President Johnson I'm talking about. If he could heed us in 1963 on voting rights, why could he never abandon his ruthless war against Southeast Asia, even after it was lost? I voted for him. We carried on the struggle against the concentration of wealth and power. On that front, the powerful beat us back on almost every front. In the capitalist strongholds, since Margaret Thatcher's day, capital has been able to keep expanding its share. The division of wealth used to be much more equal in the Soviet Union and Mao's China. That has been destroyed. And their loss of economic equality has not been accompanied by any dawn of political freedom the way ideologues of the West said it would. We carried on the defense of individual liberties. For some of us in the United States, the big preoccupation was to resist the squalid heresy hunt of the 1950s, as Ronnie recalled. The struggle included doing prison time for Dalton Trumbo, myself, and a number of others. After the hysteria abated, Trumbo out from the blacklist, for example, I kept a special interest in civil liberties. Thus, I was publicly associated with demands for the release from prison of the Uruguayan mathematician José Luis Macera, a communist, and the Soviet mathematician Anatoly Sharansky, a fellow dissident of Andrei Sakharov. Sharansky was a near clone of mine, as I had called on American courts to uphold the US Constitution's First Amendment, he was calling on Soviet courts to uphold the 1936 Soviet Constitution. Later, after he got out of prison, emigrated, and changed his name to Natan Sharansky, he looked less like my twin. He became a leader of the Israeli hard right and close to Sheldon Adelson. I don't regret at all that I stood up for his human rights in 1977. I would do the same today. It was up to my generation to leave the world habitable for our 21st century successors. For all our efforts, some of them well-directed, we failed. For all our rallying behind whistleblowers like Daniel Ellsberg and Karen Silkwood, the military-industrial clamp on information keeps its hold. Private Manning is in prison, and Edward Snowden can expect the same if he comes back home. Mordecai Vanunu has served 18 years, a very hard time, for revealing the existence of the Israeli nuclear weapons program, and he still is not allowed to leave the country. Joseph Rothblatt nominated him for the Nobel Peace Prize repeatedly. And honestly, that's some prize that goes to Henry Kissinger and not to Vanunu. For all our agitation against misuse of science and technology in organizations like Science for the People and Greenpeace, and for all the evidence that to dedicate industry to maximizing profit leads to lethal overuse of carbon fuels and lethal pollution of land and sea, the financial power and state power are an almost unbroken phalanx of devotion to profit above all. Under the so-called free trade agreements, if Ontario tries to protect its cropland by an environmental regulation, a foreign corporation may sue for the profits it figures it could have made if unregulated. By the way, can some legal historian explain to me who empowered Brian Mulroney to give secretly negotiated commercial rights precedence in law above regulations passed by ordinary parliaments? It certainly wasn't the voters. for he negotiated free trade agreements after going to the voters in 1984 on a platform against free trade. And Jean Chrétien finalized NAFTA after basing his 1988 campaign on opposition to it. So instead of passing on to the next generation a well-functioning world, my cohort is leading one that seems hell-bent for disaster. Maybe the disaster of nuclear war, maybe the disaster of environmental collapse. Which will win the honor of delivering our death stroke? It is the last moment, as the bulletin of the atomic scientists reminds us. Yet in this great jeopardy, when you must rouse yourself to better efforts than we managed just to have any future, I implore you, have the wisdom and the strength not merely to survive, but to survive proudly and happily. Choose the best future. Sadly, though, we failed our mission, and we may have learned something trying. Let's see if I can at least pass on a few lessons. First, if you're acting in a way that looks safe and sane, you should worry. You may be doing something gravely wrong. When those who currently wield the power are steering the world to disaster, you know you must break some rules. Noam Chomsky insists on this, but I don't need to cite on any authority. The point is clear. I remember several years ago an incident recounted by my late friend Yen Shi. She had mentioned my name to a senior administrator, a much admired man. He snorted, "Chandler Davis, he's an adventurist." Yen had a sharp tongue. No doubt she came up with a tart retort. Now, what would that big man have meant by adventurist? Probably he meant to dismiss me as an extremist, one of those uncivil anti-war protesters, hence not a serious colleague. Of course, I relish this as an unintended compliment. U of T would be less of a university if nobody was stepping out of line, and I'm happy to fill that role. The first guiding motto is, be an extremist. Push the boundaries. Second, to take an extreme position is often necessary, but it is not sufficient. It depends what extreme position it is. To believe the earth is flat will make you stand out from the herd, but it's wrong, and truth is preferable. Obviously, if one extreme position is right, most other extreme positions are wrong, even though extreme. The second guiding motto is, be right if you can. Third, it's not enough to be right. It wasn't enough for the legendary Cassandra to see what was going on because she wasn't able to affect it. In 1846, Henry Thoreau was right to oppose the government's war on Mexico, and he did well to express his opposition by going to prison. But going to prison didn't stop the war or end slavery. And today, I'm very glad that The Guardian has sold all its stock in companies mining hydrocarbon fuels. But if the Koch brothers buy all those shares and buy the government permission to drill in the Chukchi Sea, the damage will be the same as if The Guardian had authorized the drilling. In the real world, The Guardian is not only divesting, it's backing campaigns for everyone to divest. Is that enough? What more is needed? In the same real world, six Greenpeace activists have boarded the enormous Shell Oil floating drill rig bound for the Arctic. Long life to them. The third guiding motto is, sometimes it isn't enough to be right if too many other guys are wrong. Yet sometimes you just have to stand up, even if you're alone. Sure, don't flinch. Fourth, being right has a power of its own. Thoreau didn't just go to prison, he made a point by it, at least to a few people. Many of us got to work helping war resistors like Thoreau, especially during the Vietnam War. In the Toronto Anti-Draft Committee, we welcomed draft refusers and deserters, and this was not just compassionate. They had special value to Canadian society, bringing a special message of courage and moral clarity. I wish I had done as much for the conscientious resistors to the present wars. They're a noble lot. Thanks to all who have bucked the current. Their truth goes marching on. So the fourth guiding motto is, if you find yourself in the right but alone, give the other guys all chances to join you. Don't insist on remaining a solitary Cassandra. Now we get less obvious. Fifth, sometimes a seemingly centrist position is really the right way. So in other words, a bold extreme position like Thoreau's sometimes looks deceptively like a centrist compromise. Extremism not only is not sufficient, it isn't even always a usable criterion. I'll show you three ways this can happen of increasing subtlety. Example 5A. If you're surrounded by Serbs hollering that all the Kosovars should go away and leave the land to the Serbs, and Kosovars hollering that all the Serbs should go away and leave the land to them, and if you are so brave as to try to be a peacemaker, you may superficially be seen as taking an intermediate position between two extremist camps. That's not so. To make peace in a quarrel is not a blend of the quarreling positions. It is a qualitatively different position. Okay? Example 5B. When the student protesters were at their height around 1970, extremist crazies at Columbia or Sir George Williams in Montreal or Stanford, seeing how the universities served the ruling class, might announce their aim to destroy the library or the computer lab. The armed power of the state would oppose them. We radical academics were on the spot. Were we really so wishy-washy that we took the middle ground? I argued that we were not. The conservatives wanted to preserve institutions as they were. The crazies wanted to destroy them. We should want to transform them. And that is not any kind of compromise or average between preserving them and destroying them. Example 5C. Do we believe what scientists say? On the one hand, some skepticism is always in order, if only because human knowledge is never quite perfect. On the other hand, we want collective intelligence and not only solo intelligence to be brought to bear on problems. And that means that one scientist must be able to believe another. To achieve this, it seems to follow that we must always trust what a qualified scientist says. Otherwise, we would be sabotaging the process of compiling collective wisdom. If only it were that simple. But it's not. Especially nowadays, when a medical researcher can get a huge payday for a much prescribed pill, but can be defunded or fired for exposing a pill's dangers, and when a government environmental scientist can be forbidden to talk to the public about the dangers, or fired, and when developing genetically modified crops gets vastly better funding than impartially evaluating their effects, we seem to be stuck with two extreme policies: to believe what is published in the scientific literature in order that there be a collective body of knowledge, or to believe none of it because the social structure that generates and legitimates it is corrupt. Knowing that compromised positions are suspect, we might be tempted to go to the establishment trusting extreme or to the denialist extreme. But hold on. They're both plainly wrong. And there is no coherent middle ground of sort of half-trusting the scientific literature. We have to work hard to build, alongside the established apparatus of scientific societies, publication counts, citation indexes, and the like, a parallel canon of scientific discourse we have real confidence in. This is not the unthinking centrism which disempowers us. It is a monstrously big challenge, and we face it every day. So the fifth guiding motto is, it's harder to find your way than the first four guiding mottos make out. I didn't say I had answers to all questions, and sure enough, I'm leaving us with plenty to keep us busy.
So we have a series of questions that were provided to us by students and members of the community, and I'm going to kick off the discussion first with some of these questions, and then we're going to open it up for the audience to ask questions. Your observation on the Manhattan Project and subsequent events were an eloquent reminder of the continuing yet underappreciated threat of nuclear war. Now, perhaps even more likely than ever because of nuclear proliferation. However, the threats are now multiple, asymmetric, and multiply unpredictable. And there no longer is a single entity or confrontation to highlight or lobby against. What is a progressive to do now? These are not my questions.
Shall I start? Well, before we get into the answer to that, let me just say a few things. I'm Howard Hu, and welcome. And I first want to thank the Institute for Global Health, Equity, and Innovation, the director, Alex Ronnie, the senior strategist, for taking on the Pakula. I think this whole theme of safe spaces is absolutely fantastic. I gotta say from the outset that one of the most controversial things about appearing today was what to wear. Because first I understood that Chandler was already had an academic career in the 1950s, so I figured I should probably wear a bow tie. And then I realized that he was a progressive, an activist, and worked very hard at some of the key movements. And then I was thinking, well, I'll wear that bandana I wore in the 1980s. And then I realized this was Andrew Pakula's lecture series, and I said, well, I probably should wear a t-shirt and jeans. So that was the first controversy in our family. But the second is that, Chandler, you have nothing to apologize for your generation. From my generation's point of view, that is classic Monday night quarterbacking. I don't think there's anything different that our generation could have done to anticipate the unanticipatable, and to think through what had never been done or the kind of challenges that were presented by something as game-changing as nuclear weapons. If anything, we're thankful that we got this far without completely destroying ourselves or the world. So actually my first act is to thank Chandler's generation, many of whom are here today, for getting us where we are today.
Well, I wasn't kidding. I mentioned some of the times that we were right. I mentioned Theodore Sturgeon and I before the RAND Corporation had a moral position on nuclear arms. Sturgeon's daughter is here, by the way. Welcome. sometimes we were right. And we were overwhelmed by the move to arms and the move to war. But we started out right. Some things we missed completely. We didn't realize that the most of us didn't realize when the nuclear buildup was just beginning that there could be 10,000 nuclear weapons in the world. And we didn't realize that in the enthusiastic race to make more and more nuclear weapons, there would be more and more nuclear plants under the ridiculous pretense that they were an efficient way to provide power for society, and that the world without nuclear war would be as dangerously polluted by radioactivity as if we had had the nuclear war. I think we missed that, and now we have to catch up.
Yeah, in answer to the question that was raised, I guess I have two answers. One of them is that the world is a lot flatter, as you know, and we can put information into the hands of people wherever there's an opportunity to raise the question of nuclear disarmament and get them active, because that's probably the greatest lever to actually create sunshine on programs that are secret and to develop a movement. The second is that there's so much more to nuclear weapons than simply them sitting in silos waiting to be activated and go off. The research commission that Ronnie mentioned, I chaired, was very busy trying to understand what the health and environmental effects were of the nuclear weapons industry, even if not a single additional bomb was exploded. And if you look at the incredible amount of waste and fallout that's been generated, not only from the atmospheric testing, but even from the underground testing, and the wastes that were created throughout the world that were secret. You couldn't even find out where they were, or what rivers they were dumped in, or where they were buried. Then you'd begin to understand what the actual footprint of nuclear weapons was in the world. And that's what our commission did, is take as much declassified information we could to examine this. And some of this, even now, very few of us realize. I'll just give you an example. In 1958, a gigantic tank of nuclear waste that was created by the Russian atomic weapons industry in Chelyabinsk reached criticality and exploded. And 20 million curies of radioactivity was spread out through the South Ural Mountains, killing hundreds and mobilizing tens of thousands to be evacuated. Not a single press report on that. The CIA figured it out within 3 months, and then they suppressed that information. Why? Because they knew very well that the US nuclear weapons industry had the very same tanks in Hanford, in Oak Ridge, and other places, and they didn't want to alarm the US public or raise questions about what this might actually represent as a risk to the US. So much of what our job is to use science to shed light in all aspects of this. And with proliferation, it means not here, not just here, in Russia, Israel, Pakistan, India, so many other places. But we have a lot of the tools to do that. And that's part of our job.
Yeah. The reason I brought this magazine with me is that my friend Gordon Edwards has a very nice article in it. He's one of our strongest allies in Ontario. I'm not actually quoting from Gordon Edwards, though. I'm just quoting on this point from recent news. You may have noticed that after the
accident at Fukushima, which could easily happen here. TEPCO teams got to work trying to clean up the mess, and they found that it was rather difficult because the containers had been melted through, and the radioactive things had got down into the foundation. The technical engineer in charge of the cleanup has accepted a deadline of 2017, or in the outside 2021, to finish the cleanup, but has no idea how. This was in small type at the bottom of the news story. They don't know what to do. I don't blame them. I don't know what to do either. But the point is that any one of these hundreds of nuclear power plants, which are supposed to be relieving the energy shortage around the world, can produce the same danger. And it was all a fraud. It was all a fraud motivated by the weapons program. This is not as certain as the other things I said, but this is my view. The people were so enthusiastic about the weapons, and of course, the companies involved were enthusiastic about the profits to be made off the public purse, that they pretended that nuclear weapons, that nuclear power plants were efficient, maybe cheaper than hydrocarbon fuel. In order to pretend that, they had to ignore the cost of safety. They had to ignore the cost of cleanup, and they had to ignore the danger of accidents, even though the damage from accidents was known from the beginning to be so great that no insurance company would stand for any premium cover the damage from a nuclear accident. That's why the Price-Anderson bill and all the rest. It was a con game. It was a fraud. And we're still living with the results. And once everybody sees the light, the nuclear waste will still be there. And I don't know what to do about it.
Okay, the next question. Is it possible to be seen as an objective scientist generating or citing evidence on difficult questions while also being an advocate?
You go first. I think in my case, although I ran this commission for the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War, I actually never did research on nuclear issues such as radiation epidemiology. My research related to other environmental health issues, and that's where I found, at least for myself, a boundary that worked, where I could work in my science, generate evidence for other activists to be advocates on, but create a firewall and work on things that I felt were places where I didn't do science, but I could really take a position on. That worked for me. I don't think that always works, and there are some fuzziness places to it, too. Even the things that I worked in, I did 25 years of research on low-level lead toxicity to children and adults. One of my badges of honor was being sued twice for our data from companies that wanted to look at our data in a way so that they could refute some of the regulatory changes that were proposed based on our studies. That was something that we worked with the NIH to respond to, and I had to defend, but that's just scientific defense. It's not advocacy. Right. So it worked for me, but others have had to walk different lines.
I have heard Gordon Edwards attacked as merely an advocate, merely a political actor. I think I can believe everything he says. Maybe my friend Dave, who said this, is here and would like to take the floor. no, I guess he didn't make it. I can't see it. It seems to me that if you get your facts straight and you see that the situation requires action, then to stand up for the action is your duty.
What do you see as current examples or threats to scientists' ability to speak out on difficult issues?
Let me have it in front of me. This one?
Yeah, this one. What do you see as current examples?
Oh, excuse me. Okay, you skipped this one.
Yeah, I'll go back to
it. That's all right.
So what do you see as...
current examples or threats to scientists' ability to speak out on difficult issues.
Yeah. Well,
do you feel like you can speak to this? Are you feeling threatened?
I'd like to speak to it. I've taken public action on several of the current issues, and I'd like to trumpet them, because I think that they need more attention. I mentioned one, the skewing of scientific results as presented in the scientific literature. Elia, did you make it? Elia's not here either, too bad. Okay, I can quote him. He likes to quote in his course on psychopharmacology, Marsha Angel, who says, "I've reluctantly come to the conclusion after 18 years as editor of the New England Journal of Medicine that you can't believe the scientific literature." And that's, of course, because of the distortion resulting from the enormous financial pressure to report results in a way that will be most satisfactory to the either the pharmaceutical corporation, in the case of Marsha Angel, and Elia Abidjaoud would be concerned with the pharmaceutical industry, or in other cases the arms industry, pointing out the waste and danger of the world's arms is bad for business. And you may find that it's hard to get away with giving the facts. I think that we certainly should mention also the attack on the Lancet magazine recently. I think that that Richard Horton has done a wonderful job. Well, Marsha Angel did a wonderful job too, but Richard Horton has done a wonderful job as an editor in the medical research field. A distinguished group of a couple of hundred, mostly scientists, has called on his publisher to kick him out because they didn't like what he said about Gaza. Well, they didn't say he had said anything wrong about Gaza. They just didn't like what he said about Gaza. Now, here I can't quote the statements on both sides, but I've read the statements on both sides, and you can too. And they're quickly available online. You'll find my name among the signers of the statement in defense of Horton. I think that it will be a tragedy if he is if they succeed, but they won't.
Well, I totally agree with the notion that science these days has many opportunities for corruption in terms of who's funding the science or who is influencing the science in a way that isn't involving direct funding. There's little substitution, in my view, for the kind of transparency that will allow science to be replicated and for the general public to gain access as taxpayers to science that's either publicly funded or even privately funded. And that's my feeling about it. There's also the more subtle bias in science, of course, the tendency to publish or emphasize positive results versus negative results. One of my professors actually had a very good suggestion for that, which was to actually, when you submit your manuscript, you state the hypothesis, you outline the methods, and then instead of publishing the results, you put up the tables and they're all blank. And the reviewers basically have to make a decision on the paper just based on the hypothesis and the methods that were used. And the results are immaterial. Because if the hypothesis was good and the methods were sane and rigorous, it doesn't matter what the results were. That proposal never went anywhere.
It wouldn't have gotten funded.
But I think it's part of the long discourse that scientists have with their audience and the general public on the veracity and the trustability of science. Because if you don't have that, we're not going to get anywhere.
It's gotten quite a lot worse in the last few years. I think Margaret Eichler is here, and a few others of the Valiant Band Scientists for the Right to Know. The whole research programs get closed down because they're not to the liking of the Harper government. And what's needed is a discourse which goes beyond the standard scientific literature and the standard courses. We have to make ourselves heard, and not only politically, but to each other. We have to have our own channels of communication.
What are examples of difficult issues you see today that need to be addressed but are being ignored by the scientific or academic community?
Too big a subject.
Wait, what did you just say?
Too big a subject.
Too big a subject?
One of the advantages I have is that as an academic in Canada is that I'm relatively new. I arrived in 2012 after a career in the U.S. And so I don't think I'm on the radar screen of the Harper government yet.
Yeah. Look out.
But from my point of view, there's lots that has to be done in this country on the resource extraction industry, whether it's mining, whether it's oil, it's tar sands, even forestry and the and their effects not only on the general public because of the globalization of world trade, but also particularly on the marginalized populations that tend to live in areas that are most likely to be affected. These are difficult issues to study. They require extraordinary resources and resource development, not just your usual science budget, because the investments go much deeper than simply coming up with a methodology and recruiting people with you know, some subject incentives. It's really about building trust, about building research infrastructure and education about why is research important and what its value added is to communities that are struggling just to get basic resources. So that's, you know, my feeling that is particularly germane to Canada.
We've mentioned several already, and I think that one that I'd like to add is the study of biological systems, of ecosystems. You don't get results quickly enough for the corporate funders, and nowadays you don't get the right results either, because if you study the agricultural and the wildland impartially, you discover the damage being done by profit-making activities like mining and monoculture crops, and that's interfering with the profits. Nevertheless, the study has to be done, and it doesn't give results quickly, and so the demand that people be funded and people be supported to do this work has to be pushed intensively. Potential students of these subjects are there. Young people know that this is an exciting field, but who's going to pay the grocery bill?
Okay, this is our last question before we open it up to the audience. And this is for Chandler. You said to make peace in a quarrel is not a blend of the quarreling positions. It is a qualitatively different position. Can you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, let me expand on the example I gave. If you look at Kosovo 30 years ago, you see that there is hostility between the Serbs and Kosovars, and they have different religion, they speak different languages, and they each of them may resent the other's presence. Ibrahim Rugova was conducting a political movement of reconciliation, and was crowded out of the spotlight by NATO, and which wanted to make this a proxy war. Well, never mind my theory about the motives, but whatever the motives, it became a place where no demand could be heard, except the Serbs saying to the Kosovars, get out, and the Kosovars saying to the Serbs, get out. Now, not only we at a distance, but followers of Rugova on the spot could see that there was an alternative, and it had no resemblance to the demands of either ethnic group, and was unarmed and could not be confused with either of the struggling parties.
Thank you. We're now going to open it up for questions from the audience for either Chandler or Howard. So I encourage you to ask questions. Oh, yes, and there's several microphones right here in the middle of the. Is that how we're doing?
I think I'm famous for asking the first question. this question is for Chandler or Howard. You've spent a lot of time talking about nuclear war, which obviously is extremely important, but if you look around the world at conflicts today, they really are early 20th century wars and maybe even 19th century wars, you know, with the arms being grenades and shrapnel bombs and that sort of thing. So I'd like your thoughts about that, linked with the fact you mentioned the military-industrial complex, and what role you think the munitions industries have in perhaps perpetuating some of those wars.
That's a great question. One of the achievements, I think, in the last 10 years we can be thankful for was the campaign to ban landmines, for which several organizations, including the campaign itself and Physicians for Human Rights and others, won the Nobel Peace Prize about 6 or 7 years ago. That was a small step in trying to address low-tech warfare and some of its collateral effects, because the victims almost invariably were civilians. But today's carnage, as you pointed out, still remains a low-tech affair, mostly internal civil conflicts. There's clearly an arms industry that is fueling all of that, a lot of it related to the kinds of politics that are partly related to the military-industrial complex, but also clearly foreign policy extensions of the great powers or smaller powers that are vying for privilege. I don't have a solution to that. I think that you know, one of the things that I feel is a unremedied place where the United Nations can make advances is understanding that no longer can the UN look at simply member state status as the ticket to actually accessing UN action or UN investigation. That's precisely why, as part of my experience with the Physicians for Human Rights in 1988, we went to the Iraq-Turkey border to look at the victims that were attacked with chemical weapons by Hussein, because in fact when the UN had a special team of investigators to investigate these allegations, both Turkey and Iraq said, no, there's no evidence of this, we don't see any evidence, and we don't really need a UN investigation. And because the Kurds who were attacked had no member status in the UN, they could not ask for that. So we need mechanisms to get at these conflicts and the underlying roots to them that supersede national boundaries and nation status, but that still is something that is a taboo subject in the UN. That would be my first stab at a response.
Another remark. Conflicts, the low-tech conflicts, sometimes have attracted attention, and an example of successful international cooperation for peace was the agreement to outlaw chemical weapons a long time ago, and more recently the agreement to outlaw landmines. And that didn't make all the stocks of chemical weapons go away, and it didn't make landmines go away, but I think it surely limited the use of these weapons in these marginal conflicts.
You talked about international elements of it, but when you think of countries like England, France, Germany, the US, where, you know, munitions manufacturing is a major industry, I am not at all very involved in activist movements, but I do have to ask the question about national, internal kinds of movements in order to stop those industries. And your thoughts on that.
You've asked the unaskable, and I think that this deserves some experts who are closely involved in those to really get at what are the preventable issues. I don't have a good answer for that.
Yeah, but she's asking, if I understand, that ought not the public in the countries which are supporting distant conflicts by exporting arms to make some demands, some restrictions on them? Yes, there are a few people in Canada who would like Canadian arms to stop flowing to extremely aggressive foreign powers like Israel, but there aren't very many. the arms industry is regarded by a lot of people as simply an industry like the fertilizer industry.
And there is the Arms Exportation Act in the U.S., but its interpretation is about as politicized as it can possibly be.
Alex?
Okay. We are trying to create safe spaces, spaces where we can talk about the difficult issues of our time, and especially those that we avoid because they are either dangerous or scary for other reasons. I would like to hear your picks. Go wild. What would be your top pick for the biggest elephant in most rooms, the biggest taboo, or the most neglected question because of the scary nature of the potential answers?
Here's one. Are there any reporters in the room?
As a matter, we are recording, we can delete the whole thing, okay? And this is the right attitude. There may be microphones here, but...
I think all of us are aware that a growing issue that is at root for so many things are the inequities that are now a subject of our own Institute for Global Health, and many of them rooted in inequities of power, income, living standards, all of them with impacts on health. I guess the way
make
I
it,
would...
Make it more difficult.
Okay, here's the difficult
too polite
piece of it.
Be bold. Go for it.
Okay.
Breathe deeply.
All right.
Okay.
When I grew up, part of actually my own unaskable is how do I, as a person of Chinese heritage, how do I talk about political systems that relate to my heritage and the heritage of the country that I was born in, which is the United States. In the 1960s and the 1970s, when I was growing up, for me, even to mention the word communism or socialism was an immediate way to brand myself as, oh, Mao Zedong, you know, you're just one of those, you know, Chinese radicals. And I used to get fights in it and all the time. I guess today, in 2015, when I think about inequities, and the spectacular inequities that are growing, my first thought is, so what's so bad about socialism? You know, how about the Scandinavian countries that some of us study, some of us has visited, but I still very rarely hear comparisons to what our friends do on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, which is have systems, political systems, that are much closer to socialism than ours, or certainly the U.S.
Even the political system of Germany and France, surprisingly enough, is much closer to socialism than what you see in North America. And it would be really interesting to go into the analysis of why this is. But I don't think we can do that this afternoon. But I think that really, at some point, we have to throw off our chains.
And what's your pick? What would be your pick for an unaskable or unasked question or a big taboo? The one, if you had to pick one taboo to bring to the open now, knowing what you know, or the most difficult question that we should face as a species?
That's hard. I think many problems have to be solved at once.
Okay, so, and how could you make us all feel uncomfortable with something that we need to face?
The connection that I see between a problem like closing down the nuclear industry and some of the other problems we've mentioned is power. And the connection is that the system is defined in such a way as to disempower the large majority of people. And in the process of solving the other problems of society, it will be necessary to insist on power being devolved to people who are not shareholders in Goldman Sachs.
Thank you. Is it possible that we are screwed and there is nothing else we can do? and if that might be the case, then what do we do?
Oh, we've told you some things that we can do. I don't claim it's easy.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, I'm feeling kind of emboldened to ask an unaskable and an elephant in many of the rooms that I have visited here, both in the West and in the East. And that has to do with how does one, or is it even possible, to hold Saudi Arabia accountable for its role in funding terrorism and in also in oppressing fellow Muslims, whether it be Shias or Ahmadis or Sufis. So there seems to be a lot of talk in whispers, but nobody is willing to ask that question outright. We were able to do, say, organize a boycott of South Africa, but we have never held Saudi Arabia accountable for gender apartheid or stuff like that. So I'd love some advice on where to go with this.
On how to influence things on the other side of the world.
I'm sorry?
You mean on how to influence things on the other side of the world?
No, not necessarily. Even here, because we are friends with Saudi Arabia, just as, we promote it. So it has boycotts from here influences what happens there, and raising the question and the issues here also impacts on what we do, both at home and worldwide.
Well, my first reaction would be is if we had heeded the advice of some of our colleagues on the engineering left and were much less dependent on fossil fuels today, there'd be a lot more courage in demanding some accountability from a regime that is remains a major oil producer, but as you said, is engaged in questionable practices and human rights abuses in its own country. That would be my first thought as a response. But even without that, that's a tall order. I think you're right in that the conversations don't even happen very much. They're given occasional highlighting in investigative journalism, but it's not a consistent way of looking at foreign policy that of this country or certainly the U.S. And there's no way of not only influencing, but getting the debate to think about what are the alternatives? And that's, I think that's a great unaskable question.
Well, I'm hoping we will start to ask that more often. Thank you.
If part of the problem that has led to the many situations that we currently face is both the balance of power, and that it can be more or less recognizable in certain circumstances, that many of these problems come from power itself and any level of concentration, how can we work towards bringing things towards a situation that empower people more from the ground up and level things in that way, and sort of leveling from the top down and empowering from the ground up. But if not just the level, but the very nature of power is what's led to so many of these problems, how can we reasonably rely on the apparatus of the state or other forms of granting people legitimacy based on their positions of power, which need to be addressed? And how can one, is there any fair way to have people have any kind of power from recognition that doesn't require extremely vigilant checks and balances?
I guess my, what I would say is that I think one of the great hopes and advances has been information technology. Information is power. And the ability today for an Edward Snowden to leave the National Security Agency with a couple little flash drives and instantly change the world is power. And our ability to manage that information and the ability for the average person on the street to receive that information and interpret it is sort of the following stage of how we are able to distribute that power and use that power and get it into the right hands so that it can actually start fomenting change. So I think it's on some level, there's a power shift already happening. Since I'm over 25 years old, I'm not the expert on information technology or how the revolution in information technology will change the world, but I see it as a huge driver.
So people have been talking about the elephant in the room. I wanted to talk about the grass that's outside of the room. And I'm referring to the African proverb that I've heard that when the elephants fight, it's the grass that suffers. And particularly in this university, we have very little representation, I think, of the majority of the world. And I think an answer to the question around taboo topics, some has been addressed here, but there's been some really good work by some individuals present looking at the corporation of the University of Toronto. I myself was one of those crazy students at Columbia in 1968 that Chandler referred to, and we had a president who had been a member of, he'd been in the CIA and supposedly was involved in Patrice Lumumba's assassination. Although when I Googled it recently, I didn't find the link. But I think our universities are complicit in training people in the military-industrial complex. The Canadian mining companies that are creating so much destruction in the world and displacement. There's been an article in the Globe and Mail on the migrants who are dying at sea in the Mediterranean, that actually the West is producing them and manufacturing them at a high rate. And Chandler did mention a taboo topic, which is Israel. When I was a student at Columbia, a predominantly Jewish school in New York, in the 67 war, there was an immense and rapid split in the left that I think it was apparent for everyone to see. And the last thing I'll leave you with is Martin Luther King, who said exactly a year before he was assassinated, with state complicity, according to a civil suit that his family brought, he said, "My nation is the greatest purveyor of violence in the world." So, thanks. Your comments.
Well, thank you for bringing up the general question of the criminals in our midst. Of course, it's true that as we and other leftists charged in the 60s and 70s that the university conducts a lot of the business of the people who are misleading the economy and the governments. And our normal courtesy toward our colleagues when we sit down to eat in the faculty club should not override our serious judgment on what they are engaged in, because some of them, I mentioned Henry Kissinger, may have perfectly valid academic degrees and be perfectly qualified in some academic sense, and that doesn't stop them from being war criminals. Indeed, it may help. So I think that this is one thing which is unfortunately necessary to us, to insist on opening our eyes to the role of some things that go on in the university. I really think, though, that another thing which is another kind of blindness which disempowers us, unfortunately and avoidably, is the assumption that whatever you can pay for, you have a right to. There's no such rule. And and things which are dependent at present on financial resources being available should be subjects of social choice, which should be made in a way which has yet to be invented and which will overrule the market.
Let me try to give a brief response. I would welcome information about war criminals at the University of Toronto. That may be a taboo subject, but truth should shine, and we should know about it. That doesn't mean infringement of free speech. It simply means the right to know. And I'm all in favor of a university community where we can pillory each other and debate each other and make this a microcosm of some of the big debates and that occur in society within the framework of civility and university discourse, but that's a necessary part of trying to make progress, in my point of view. The one thing, additional thing I wanted to say is that at the School of Public Health, one of the things I'm very proud of, and the Institute has been very involved in this, is the creation of a whole new program for undergraduates, starting with our big course called Grand Opportunities in Global Health. This is a course that addresses the big issues of the day, whether it's Ebola or food security or SARS, AIDS, global health politics and power. And it was instantly oversubscribed by undergraduates the very first day it was launched. We intend to grow this into a very big initiative. But the major audience is not undergraduates who we believe are going to become our own graduate students. It is the students who are going to be going into business school, law school, become politicians, become entertainers, become business owners, because we want to create literacy in why it is health is so important, why there is such big disparities in health, why it's so important to address those disparities as the in the course of normal development of human society, because it's important for everybody to know. And we hope that that will have a ripple effect to advance the people who will become folks who have their levers on the war machines, on the industries that matter, and everything else. And that, I think, is part of what the positive role that universities have.
Chandler, the first part of your presentation, you focused on the danger, the threat, which was certainly very real to all of us who grew up in your generation. And I must confess, I came to maturity only a few years later. And it was a central concern, the fear that we had the capacity to totally destroy human life in one day. Now that issue seems to have passed from this, it has ceased to become a central concern. In fact, even in your presentation, you looked at the atomic issue, the nuclear issue, more in environmental ways. I wonder if you could say, and this is really for both of you, the way in which the danger, there's still about, I don't know how many thousand bombs sitting around the world.
The way in which what?
The question is, how does the existence of the capacity, the nuclear capacity today, to what degree is that an issue? It has moved off the center stage. It is not what people are talking about. They're talking about much more about environmental issues. How important is that nuclear issue? And I wonder if you could talk about what we should be doing about it.
Yeah, I think that it's partly obfuscation. I think that people speak about nuclear stockpiles as if they were defensive. That's a habit which has been pushed since the development that I talked about. The pretense that retaliatory strike was usable deterrent. But the main thing is that it has become a grand illusion understood by nobody, and the misunderstanding is heavily subsidized by the nuclear industry, which is invisible.
Even if it were true that you could win a nuclear war, you would presumably win it by destroying 10 or 20 cities of a prospective opponent. And that would require something less than 100 nuclear weapons. The United States has over 10,000. What are they doing? They are making the cash register ring at the owners of the nuclear arms industry. The nuclear arms industry does not have competitors. It is a state monopoly in effect, but for private profit. And this is a, well, I described it as a con game, but it's so much worse. The reforming president we thought had been elected in 2008 is continuing on a program of spending $1 trillion in constant dollars, if the dollar will kindly remain constant, on refurbishing the nuclear stockpile. For what? For what? If Iran, who's the only antagonist they're happy to talk about, had one nuclear weapon, it would not be a threat to anybody, even a non-nuclear armed neighbor. One nuclear weapon is not going to win a war. Why is the 10,000 nuclear weapon stockpile necessary to maintain and strengthen in 2015? It's a fraud. Why does President Obama take it seriously? I'm afraid you'll have to ask him.
Dr. Wu, you were alluding to information technology, the importance of the internet. In the assumption that any monopoly is dangerous, I would submit that the five leading CEOs of Facebook, Google, Microsoft, and Apple probably control assets that probably supersede those of maybe 25 African countries. Don't we see something perverse about that situation? Nobody seems to question it. We're questioning, of course, the corporations in other areas, crooked pharmaceuticals, of course, the military. But in their regard, we should remember that the guidance systems that power missiles and everything else are actually software produced by many of these companies. So is there any novel suggestions that may come up? About this dangerous monopoly of, you know, four or five companies controlling the language that we use nowadays.
I think that's it's a huge issue, and I think that you know, certainly when, if you're in Europe and you're part of your European community's current analysis of Google as a monopoly, you would agree. But I think that you know, what the defenders say is that these are all related to disruptive technologies that could change next year or 2 years after that. You know, Microsoft may be number one today, 10 years from now they may not be. I don't buy that. What I do buy is that the here and now provides some almost perverse opportunities for companies like that to control segments or influence policy at the most basic level, and I do believe that there's a obligation both for the world community and the corporate community to examine how that influence is played out, and whether it's destructive or it's actually enhancing human capacity. But I don't see much scholarship in that area. That's not my area of expertise, but it doesn't feel like we have a handle on what the real potential danger is. So I would agree that's an issue.
Can I get mine?
Yes, so no, we're going to take these next two questions, and then we have a reception after. So if people are running out the door because they're hungry, just a couple more minutes, and we'll be serving some food in a few minutes.
I want to argue that it's the failure of our generation, Chandler, in not standing on the mountains and yelling, crisis. The elephant in the room is the survival of civilization. We came out of the most bloody century, the 20th century, from wars that Earth has ever seen. Right now, there are about 2,000 nuclear weapons on alert that could be fired by accident, by technological failure, or by human design. In the NATO website in Europe, you'll find there's a plea for European nations to announce to Russians, we're ready for a nuclear war. The idiots were out in force in June 1914, and we have not had a historical appreciation of where we are. We have neoliberalism that tells us economic growth is the only pattern we can have. It's one earth, it's finite. Economic growth can't happen with population growing. We need another model. And as you suggested, the one that's sharing and looks to well-being, which the Scandinavian countries do, is a good model to think about. And if we don't address climate change in the next 10 years, our children won't have any possibility of a reasonable life for their own children. So the elephant is our survival.
Hear, hear.
And if you'll take the advice of the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War, you'll believe that it's necessary to get a treaty to ban nuclear weapons and go about the business of eliminating it. And it isn't a past issue.
And observe that treaty.
I just wanted to talk from a member of a slightly younger generation and to say that I think that there's a reason for a certain amount of hope. So a lot of the problems that have been talked about have potential solutions if everybody trusted each other, if they trusted the data, if they trusted that people were going to act in a cooperative way, if people are going to act in an exploitative or belligerent way, then a lot of those solutions don't work. And so I think the answer is really the answer to the long questions about the survival of the Earth or humanity and the ecology really has to do with rebuilding, with building bridges so to enable more trust. Because in a world of at war, it's going to be very hard. I mean, basically, a lot of things just stopped during the Second World War. They stopped during the First World War. Like research towards solutions to larger problems, long-term problems of the Earth, ground to a halt. And I think that there's reason for hope. If you look at the International Space Station, you see a bunch of astronauts, scientists working together. These are nations that were at each other's throats, that were trying to annihilate each other in your generation. And they're floating around together and laughing and who knows what they're doing. And so they're looking at the Earth as one organism. They're looking at the Earth as one planet to which we all belong. And I think that's ultimately part of the task of the academic community is to establish a very strong web so that people are doing science and are sharing ideas as equals and as collaborators rather than getting mired in a lot of the wars, which there are a lot of inequities which will last, they may be the last a long time, but they ultimately, they prevent, that mistrust is the thing that's preventing these solutions from taking hold. So we've got to try to build trust through the academic community.
You're quite right. There certainly are examples of the possibility of cooperation and the possibility of trust. And at the same time that we keep producing examples of treachery, we also keep producing examples of the reverse, and we have to be able to notice them and build on them.
Chandler, on behalf of the University of Toronto, the Institute for Global Health Equity and Innovation, and the Dalhousie School of Public Health, I'd like to give you this token of our appreciation. You get to open it. Thank you again for this wonderful presentation.